Les amateurs de chocolat, ce sont vraiment trois chocolats sublimes, super, plein de goût, plein de saveurs. On est en train vraiment de se défouler avec ces trois chocolats. Et bon, j'ai fait quelques créations, autant dans des verrines, pâtisseries, desserts sur assiette et bonbons bien sûr. Je dois dire que c'était fabuleux.
Aujourd'hui, on a eu un atelier de création avec nos ambassadeurs chefs du Québec et on leur a demandé de développer des recettes à partir de notre nouvelle gamme de chocolat Q-Fermentation. Ils ont fait ça avec brio, c'était délicieux.
Yo pienso que quizá pasemos de una de un concepto más barroco, complejidad de sabores, ¿no? A una cosa más minimalista, más concreta. Es un chocolate con mucha capacidad de jugar, de adaptarse, una cobertura muy con mucho carácter.
One, two.
Es fenomenal, ¿no? Si se puede llegar a eso, se pueden hacer muchas cosas más. Ese es un primer paso, creo, de una evolución a la hora de hacer chocolate. La radicalidad, evolución y potencia. Queremos contar historias, ¿no? Y esta es una historia muy bonita.
Bonjour. Alors, je vous souhaite la bienvenue à la Guilde Culinaire pour le lancement officiel des trois nouveaux produits d'une fermentation optimisée des trois produits Alunga, Inaya et Okoa. En tant qu'ambassadeur, comme vous le savez, de Cacao Barry, vous êtes les premiers à travailler ce produit. Nous allons travailler en atelier. On vous demandera de développer un certain nombre de recettes.
Le rhum blanc peut aller. On se rend compte que le rhum ambré, le rhum brun, le rhum bio, ça va très très bien. Le whisky, c'est l'alcool qui va par excellence avec le cacao. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'il y a maltage et à la même étape de l'élaboration.
Je dis toujours que Cacao Barry est le trait d'union entre le fermier, le planteur et le maître chocolatier qui crée ses douceurs et qui est plein de créativité. Alors évidemment, ces produits ont été construits, assemblés, décidés avec les fermiers, avec les planteurs de cacao, en fusion avec les artisans chocolatiers.
Chocolat façon After Eight avec un petit sablé breton et une ganache chocolat menthe et un espumage chocolat au lait. On se fait une verrine avec un crumble chocolat, compoté de cerises, mousse chocolat et émulsion vanille. Et on se fait un dessert à l'assiette avec une anglaise au thé du Labrador, une meringue suisse à l'érable et on va normalement faire un petit croustillant chocolat feuilletine.
Alors bonjour, je m'appelle Christophe Morel.
Alors Jonathan Garnier, chef propriétaire de la Guilde Culinaire à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Olivier Potier.
Bonjour, mon nom c'est Marc Yekio, je suis au Québec depuis 37 ans et je suis propriétaire des pâtisseries Marius et Fanny.
Bonjour, Ludovic Fraisse, chef chocolatier pour Chocolat Privilège à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Nicolas Duterre, donc je suis chef pâtissier.
Bonjour, mon nom est Nancy Sanson, je suis enseignante à l'école d'hôtellerie à Trois-Rivières et j'ai une chocolaterie à Trois-Rivières également.
Amateurs de chocolat, ce sont vraiment trois chocolats sublimes, superbes, plein de goût, plein de saveurs. On est en train vraiment de se défouler avec ces trois chocolats. Et bon, j'ai fait quelques créations, autant dans des verrines, pâtisseries, desserts sur assiette et bonbons bien sûr. Et je dois dire que c'était fabuleux.
Aujourd'hui, on a eu un atelier de création avec nos ambassadeurs chefs du Québec et on leur a demandé de développer des recettes à partir de notre nouvelle gamme de chocolat Q-Fermentation. Ils ont fait ça avec brio, c'était délicieux.
yo pienso que quizá hemos pasado, pasemos de una de un concepto más barroco, complejidad de sabores, ¿no? A una cosa más minimalista, más concreta. Es un chocolate con mucha capacidad de jugar, de adaptarse, una cobertura muy, con mucho carácter. Es fenomenal, ¿no? Si se puede llegar a eso, se pueden hacer muchas cosas más. Es un primer paso, creo, de una evolución a la hora de hacer chocolate. Radicalidad, evolución y potencia. Queremos contar historias, ¿no? Y esta es una historia muy bonita.
je vous souhaite la bienvenue à la Guilde Culinaire pour le lancement officiel des trois nouveaux produits d'une fermentation optimisée des trois produits Alunga, Inaya et Okoa. En tant qu'ambassadeur, comme vous le savez, de Cacao Barry, vous êtes les premiers à travailler ce produit. Nous avons travaillé en atelier. On vous demandera de développer un certain nombre de recettes.
Le rhum blanc peut aller. On se rend compte que le rhum ambré, le rhum brun, le rhum bio, ça va très très bien. Le whisky, c'est l'alcool qui va par excellence avec le cacao. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'il y a maltage et à la même étape de l'élaboration.
Je dis toujours que Cacao Barry est le trait d'union entre le fermier, le planteur et le maître chocolatier qui crée ses douceurs et qui est plein de créativité. Alors évidemment, ces produits ont été construits, assemblés, décidés avec les fermiers, avec les planteurs de cacao, en fusion avec les artisans chocolatiers.
Chocolat façon After Eight avec un petit sablé breton et une ganache chocolat menthe et un espumage chocolat au lait. On se fait une verrine avec un crumble de chocolat, compoté de cerises, mousse chocolat et émulsion vanille. Et on se fait un dessert à l'assiette avec une anglaise au thé du Labrador, une meringue suisse à l'érable et on va normalement faire un petit croustillant chocolat feuilleting.
Alors bonjour, je m'appelle Christophe Morel.
Alors Jonathan Garnier, chef propriétaire de la Guilde Culinaire à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Olivier Potier.
Alors bonjour, mon nom c'est Marc Yecchio, je suis au Québec depuis 37 ans et je suis propriétaire des pâtisseries Marius et Fanny.
Bonjour, Ludovic Fraisse, chef chocolatier pour Chocolat Privilège à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Nicolas Duterre, donc je suis chef pâtissier.
Bonjour, mon nom est Nancy Sanson, je suis enseignante à l'école d'hôtellerie à Trois-Rivières et j'ai une chocolaterie à Trois-Rivières également.
Hello? Are we going to start? Everybody's here? Thank you for coming. It's lovely to have you all here. Heard there was some problem with parking, but it seems like most of you arrived anyway. So it's really exciting. We are partnering up today with Pregel. So it's a partner worldwide, Canada-wide, North America-wide, with Cacao Barry. So we have Chef Monty. We're very excited to have him coming to do the demo today. So he's the corporate chef for Pregel and he is also a Checco Barry ambassador. So Chef Monti has won several competitions. Like, he's originally from France, and worked in the US for many, many years at many high-end restaurants and places. Maybe during the presentation we'll come up and talk a little bit on what you have done. But he's won several competitions and been in many magazines, and I know a lot of people follow his recipes in his writings, what he's coming up with. So it's very exciting to have you here. So I think I'll let you start, and then I will talk a little bit while he's talking. So that's usually how we do it. I'll introduce Checco Barry, and we have the pre-gel. He will talk mostly about pre-gel, and then we'll kind of do the demonstration together. So welcome, everybody. Nice to have you here.
Thank you, everybody. So what we're going to do today, we're going to do two things. One would be the first to describe a verrine. A verrine is something in a glass with different texture inside, different also flavor, and the other one will be a bonbon. So we have the book in front of you. If you have a question during the class or during the demonstration, we have one microphone on my left, one microphone on the right. So of course we take the question, but if it's possible, we try to get the question at the end. If it's possible, that will be easy to continue the process. Okay. So the first thing we're going to make is on page five. We're going to start. So the recipe, they are not exactly in order, but I will tell you as we're going the page we're going for the demonstration, because of course. We did something like a TV, so I'm going to demonstrate. Some will be hot, and of course, I already have made some of the mousse or some of the gelée is already cold. Otherwise, when I build the dessert, of course, some of the complement can be melting. Example, some chocolate disc we have inside. But to talk a little bit about the dessert before we start, what I like to do, like I don't know if we see on the back when we have the video early. But it's a verrine I did also for a magazine with a tube of sugar inside with a magic sugar, so what is a isomalt with a flavor. So I like when I eat a dessert is also texture. So it's not just a mousse, a crunchy, a sponge. Today we're going to make a sponge cook in a microwave. So we're going to make some caviar, thing like this. So when you eat all together, I like to almost to really enjoy and to describe the dessert by himself. So to really, I will support this, to have a good time when I eat a dessert, not just something where one or two flavor and it's okay. So you will see.
It's amazing, by the way. I already cheated and tried it.
So the first thing, I don't know if they want to pass the video, but anyway, you can do at the same time if you can put the song a little bit less on the back. But the first thing we're going to do is a strawberry jam. So for this ingredient, I'm going to also use, they sell the puree here in Canada. So I believe we have a distributor. If somebody want to talk a little bit about this, you can. But we're going to have a strawberry puree. Sugar, pectin. Of course, we know we're mixing always sugar and pectin together. And at the end, we're going to add our strawberry. So I don't know if you have a chance outside. I believe it was a table with sampling. So you know, on the way back, on the way when we finish the class, if you want to test, if you have a question, or if you need a sample sent to you, I believe we can do that. And after, to add a little bit of stronger flavor, also we put the strawberry photo frutto. Okay? So it's very simple. Like we do a jam, we cook everything to 104, and pretty straight recipe. So. So if you want to change the flavor of this recipe, of course you can do it. What is nice with the jam, if you want also use inside an entremet or a verrine, is how you want to cook. So if you add more pectin or if you cook longer, of course it's going to be harder. But it's okay, you can do that. We have Marie's. So for this dessert, what I try to do is a strawberry. We have two types of the chocolate, milk, and a dark also. And the milk, I put a little bit of peanut, because strawberry and peanut and chocolate go well together, at least in America. But I believe it's called almost a peanut butter.
So the milk chocolate that's in there, it's our Alunga. So it is, I know a lot of you have already been to a few of our Cacao-Barry demos, but the Alunga comes from our line of Purity from Nature chocolate, which we call is made with the Q fermentation, quality fermentation. So we have figured out which ferment in the nature is actually good to improve the quality of the chocolate. And we're working with about 4,000 farmers, and they apply this natural ferment to the cocoa beans before it starts the process. And that way they have a much better yield, a much better quality cocoa once they can sell the chocolate once it's ready. So that's the Alunga, what goes in this recipe.
So what I have here is the pectin and sugar together. Bless you. I know it's cold here, can you tell? I have long sleeve.
Yeah, poor chef. I think it was a little bit of a shock to come to Canada at minus 25 and 40 in the wind. It's been a rough few days.
But I understand why in the winter time you don't need a freezer, you know? You just put the rack outside and you're okay?
He had ordered to have a blast freezer, but we decided it wasn't worth bringing in one, right?
Correct. So if you want, you can also heat the puree by himself, bring to boil and add the pectin and sugar later also. It's just here we try to go a little bit faster. So we have a thermometer. We're going to cook this. We're going to move slowly to the next recipe. So like this, in the meantime, this can cook. Also, I didn't want to present my assistant, but I have two gentlemen who assist me for the last 2 days.
So we have Rodney Alleguette, who is here, who is one of our Cacao-Barry promoters in Toronto, is helping out with a lot of our things. He's working at Ma Maison, his pastry shop on Dundas and Royal York. Really nice, beautiful croissants, beautiful pastries. So it's good to have him here. And then Francesco is hiding somewhere. He's the second.
He's on the back. So what he's doing is right now he's finishing the cotton candy, you know? So because we have to bring the machine later, because you will see it's a pretty big and big machine. So he's finishing the dessert because we make 200, because is what they told me. Hopefully a lot of people is missing today, but he's finishing the dessert on the back.
So we'll introduce him when he comes in next.
Hi everybody, I'm Daniela from Prejal. So I just wanted to mention the purees that Chef Monty is using today is our line of Monte Rico frozen fruit purees. They're made in Canada, kosher certified, and whenever possible, we always try to use Canadian fruit in them. These purees currently are being distributed in Toronto by Kihan Foods, and Alan, the sales rep, is up in the corner. So he will be able to help you with anything that you have questions on afterwards.
So this will be almost the same way you do pâte de fruit, correct? Pretty much, it's just you cook a little bit less. So the only thing I had also at the end, like I said earlier, was a strawberry, the light strawberry delight. I don't know if you talk about this, but it's also a product is very nice because it's a baby strawberry. I don't know if you have a chance to see that. You can almost use this product how it is. You don't have to make a jam or thing like this, or you can add a puree, but because by itself is already, I don't want to say a jam, but a spray almost, something very like this. And also is free.
It's sugar-free, yeah. So it's made with Splenda. It's a really delicious jam-type spread. It can be used in a variety of different applications. So chef's using it in a few different pastry applications today. It can also be used as a swirl or a ripple type product in a gelato, ice cream, or sorbetto.
All right, so that is ready.
You smell the wild strawberries? It's like amazing.
Of course, like I told you earlier, we already have some already called because we met yesterday mise en place for 300 people. So we have this, you know, we think.
You should have brought your friends.
So what I use is, like I told you earlier, is a verrine. So I'm going to put this on the bottom of the cup. So it can be sprayed also on a sponge if you want to do this. So I just put a little bit, oops, on the bottom. Okay. And the next recipe will be page 5, Alunga peanut cream. Alunga, the flavor, would you like to... So how would you describe the flavor of the Alunga?
It's a very robust, strong cocoa chocolate flavor to it. So again, this quality fermentation process, it really gives the purity out of the cocoa beans. So the cocoa bean itself has a really strong, nice flavor, but also the Alunga has a strong, it has a lot of cocoa content. This is a 41% chocolate. So milk chocolate usually is around 35 to 38. So 41 means it's much stronger in chocolate than a regular one. So it's almost like a chocolate, a milk chocolate for a dark chocolate lover. So it has a beautiful flavor. And also it has kind of a, not so, it's an easy flavor to combine with other flavors because it's a pure, again, it's a pure chocolate. So it's easily combined with other flavors.
So for this recipe, it's almost like a whipped cream. It's pretty much the same process. So it's the cream, the water together. When it's bring to boil, to simmer, put a pistol, burr mixer, and you add at the end the peanut. I don't know if you have a chance to test this outside. I believe you have some sample, but is for me one of the, I'm French, but I love peanut flavor. Like usually French people, we don't like it. It's just incredible, the crunchiness and the peanut is, so if you make this on a mousse, or if you spray on a sponge, it stays crunchy. So if you do a layer, or if you freeze, it's very nice. If you want something, example, more crunchy, so usually what I will do is take one part of the peanut crunchy and one part of the couverture, example, one-to-one, blend together, spray between transfer paper or acetate plastic, put in a freezer, and cut some disc. So like this, when you want to build an entremet, a verrine, or thing like this, that would be also a different application, how you can use it. So process the same, cream, water, bring to boil, put the chocolate, burr mixer, adding this inside, the flavor. Let it set for 24 hours. It's best to do the day before. Put in a cooler, and the next day you whip, like you will whip a chantilly. Okay? So you can also use this as an insert. because now we're putting this in a verrine. Or you can use also to finishing, example, if you want to do a raspberry peanut éclair, or maybe an entremet, thing like this. Question? No?
So how long can you make it in advance?
The minimum would be 24 hours. As long you can keep a chantilly whipped cream or a ganache, you're going to whip at least 3 days. After this, it's up to you, but I'm not going to keep to tell you to keep for a week, correct? Pretty much we're all in this business. We know exactly what to do or not do it, correct? So wait until this is going to boil. You have a spatula, all set. Wow. Yeah. What I like with this product, the salty peanut, is the crunchy. And even if you freeze, at this point, I'm going to blend inside the ganache, so of course, the crunchiness is going to disappear, but it's okay. It's exactly what I want to obtain. Almost there. All right, so. The next one will be on page 6. So, in the meantime, the cream is getting hot, warm. We're going to talk to Aqua Dark Chocolate Mousse. We're going to take an induction so we can go a little bit faster. Chef is going to start to put the cream. And I can talk at the same time. So, Aqua, I don't know if you have a chance to test, but it's a very acidic chocolate for me when you test just like this, correct? Great to make mousse, to make ganache, gelato, ice cream. I mean, it's one of the very good flavor.
So it actually has a lot of fluidity to it too, so it's good for enrobing as well.
The percentage of the chocolate.
It's 70% chocolate.
Yeah, so you can see it's very.
So it's strong in flavor, but it's if you go out later on the break, you can try the varieties. So we have the three. So there's a second dark one. So Okoa is 70%, but we have Inaya, which is 65%. And the Inaya's actually, it has more cocoa content than the Okoa. So it doesn't have as much cocoa butter. So it's really for mousses and ganaches and give a really strong chocolate flavor when you use it. But it's not very good if you're going to enrobe or do bark or do anything like that because it's really thick. So when you try it, it doesn't have the same smooth mouthfeel as the Okoa, which is really pleasant on the tongue.
So for this, I added the chocolate, correct? Then I can add right now, well, soon the crunchy from the peanut, from Prigel. Don't be afraid, you're going to see, I'm sorry, I tried to get as clear container as possible, but I was not able to get too many. So you cannot see through, but you will see, I'm going to bring, I don't know if your camera can come here. So, can you come here? Can you see inside?
See the camera?
Well, anyway, what I try to say is very liquid. Okay, so don't be afraid when you see this liquid, don't say, well, I make a mistake, it's not enough chocolate. It is, you will see the next day when you put it in the refrigerator 24 hours, it's going to be like thick, very like a paste. The only thing you have to do is to whip a little bit, and you're going to see that, but. If you want to do an robo-coupe, of course, depend the quantity you're doing. I will recommend you do an robo coupe. Also, when I put all my cream on the chocolate, I usually pour the cream on top of the pistol, and I just let it set usually for 2-3 minutes, I never use the blender or start. If I use a spatula or a whisk, I will use from the center, try to create a homogeneity, and like a mayonnaise, okay? That's it. So this go in the fridge overnight. So what I'm going to do here, the first step on a dark chocolate mousse, okay? Aqua on page 6. So we have we're going to talk about about the couverture. So we have the gelatin base, what is in powder. I don't know if you, it's pretty much like this in a, come in a bag like this. So the good thing with the gelatin base, you can use as a cold process or hot process. So I'm going to try to be more or very specific and clear as possible. What I'm going to explain is the way it comes. So example, you make a crème anglaise. Usually we know we bloom the gelatin with the water. Usually it's 5-1, correct? If you do it this way. If it's not, you just put a little bit of cold water with the gelatin, let it dehydrate it, and after melt again in a microwave, or usually you pour directly on your crème anglaise. So if you use the gelatin base, at this point, you actually can, you cook your crème anglaise to 85, and just pour on top the gelatin base. You don't have to dissolve with the milk or water, etc. Okay? Good. But what I'm going to do here, I have a little bit of milk, so you can do both ways. So I just explained how to do with no just adding at the end. Or you can remove some of the water or milk, cream, depending what you're making with this. Put your powder here. Nice cold process with a whisk. Small one. This is a small one I can't find, but this is a small one. Just go put it away.
And that's it's hard it. To be in somebody else's kitchen.
But that's it. So, see? Of course, the water is cold. I didn't warm it up at all. If the water was warm, it's okay. You can dissolve, like I say, early, cold or hot process. Either way.
You need to let it sit longer if it's cold or it melts as quickly.
It melts as quickly the way it is. So at this point, what I did here, chef, warm the cream. So the first one was the cream. You add the chocolate pistol, again, dissolved. You add on top the gelatin base with a little bit of cold milk. And that goes, we put this on the side to get to cool down, because of course if I add the whipped cream at this point, it's going to be too hot and it's not the right temperature, okay? So this recipe for this mousse, I always call this recipe the emergency. And I say that in a sense like, it's no pâte à bombe, you know, it's no complicity, a mousse. So it's one part, so it's got, it would be two parts, and you add exactly the same part of cream. So example, I'm going to give you two examples, one in gram, one in cup. One cup cream, one cup chocolate, become 2 cups, and now you're whipping 2 cups of whipped cream. 100 gram, you're whipping 200 gram, that's it. 1 kilo, 1 kilo, 2 kilo. So this recipe is very easy to make it. It's also good for the restaurant because it's pretty much, you know, restaurant work almost like instant. You don't like make too much mise en place or because you don't know how much people is going to buy. But usually, you know, 60 to 70% is more chocolate on your menu than something else. I don't know if you can see with the light, but like a torioli, I put the cream and create the motion, mayonnaise, and you can see it's very, very smooth. And of course, add the cold milk.
The reason of putting the cold milk?
Well, the reason to add the cold milk is actually to cool down quickly the process. You don't have to warm everything, like, because that was the gelatin base. So I'm going to put this in a bowl right here. So if I want to check the temperature right now, to give you approximately, should be around 50, 52. I don't know if you see that, but it's about 52, and you wait until, you can add your whipped cream soft peak around 25, 22. Sometimes you can add a little bit warmer, depend. If you pipe right away, it's not going to set, but depend the texture.
So 50, it's what right Celsius?
Now we're talking Celsius.
That's 50 mm-hmm. is Fahrenheit.
That was Fahrenheit? No, we're in Celsius.
Celsius?
Yes.
It's 50 now Celsius, okay.
It's 50 right now. So you let it cool down here, or you put a plastic wrap so you don't get the skin to the top. Usually, if you do that a couple hours, or put in a fridge. Or I see people also sometimes do this on a ice bath. If you do this, you know the bottom can cold quickly, so you have to very be careful with this, the way to do this. All right. Right here, we're going back on page 5. So we're going to whip Alunga peanut cream. Marisa. So for this variant, whatever, you can have something, these doors are plastic, you can have something more elegant, you know. Different technique people sometimes, and it depends on your creativity also, you can take the gem, take a spatula and maybe spray the gem around the side. So people on one side, this is the gem. The other side, they do nothing or just do halfway. So I keep it very simple. It's up to you. Simplicity sometimes is the best. When you try to do too complicated, people don't understand. You confuse people even more. It depends on the market. Who are your customer, the most of this. So we're going to whip the... So that's exactly actually the way it is. And I'm going to show you. So it's pretty thick. For a small quantity like this, I can almost whip by hand, but we're going to do. Now, if you ever whip this, but it's not like you can try to get it back, but if you are very be careful when you whip because it can change very quickly, so you can make butter, yes. If you see you ever whip, if it's not too late, what you can do is to add a little bit of milk, you know, just in case. So right now we have the jam. We're going to put the peanut, what I call, you can call a crémeux almost, or a chantilly if you want. Then after we're going to put a disc of chocolate, a milk chocolate disc. Huh? What?
Non, juste pour le plat. Il demande quand c'est à l'heure.
Oh, si tu veux commencer à amener, tu peux. Ouais. Non? I can see everybody looks very tired, so we can start the degustation as we go. So like this, a little bit of sweetness going to bring you to speed. In case you fell asleep on your chair. You can tell if people fell asleep over there. All right, a little bit more. It's hard to see those, you know, those new machine technology they do today. They put so much protection. You can almost not see the, you don't see too much what you're doing. Which was it be? All right, let's see, it's ready. All right. So I don't see if you see very well, but the texture, like I said earlier, don't over whip, soft peak would be nice. See if you have a scraper. In the corn. Tu peux tenir le bol. À la place. Je sais pas pourquoi il y a des grains.
C'est le pinot.
C'est bon. Just a little bit like this. The next will be the disc. So we did some disc and chocolate. Thickness, not too thick, but just enough to have a crunchy. So you can see, I believe on the camera better. So what you do is you place. And you push, see this one crack here? You can see because it's too thin. All right. For this variant, we're going to have two layer of chocolate disc. This will also give a nicer texture. Correct?
That chocolate disc was made with aluga?
Yes. And of course, if you want to put vanilla beans, you see sometimes from time to chef people adding flavor inside, but I believe the way it is one of the creamy, light, milky flavor. I don't have a chance to try, it's fantastic. So,
what we're going to do, we're going to pass around. Leanne went to get some alunga, so we were going to try just the chocolate on its own.
Correct. So we're going to make some, right now we're going to the page, Raspberry Pearl, page 6. So is anybody, everybody pretty much know how to make caviar, correct? Or at least see one time somewhere on video, thing like this. That is pretty much the easy way you can make caviar. Any other puree you can use, any other flavor, pretty simple. So, puree, raspberry, today is going to be raspberry. You mix with the sugar and the raspberry also compound. So we have also, on five-star line, Siri. We have a line, I don't know exactly how many you have.
We have four of the most popular five-star Chef Pastry Select line of compounds. These were made specifically, Chef helped develop them for the pastry sector. So we have a raspberry compound, strawberry, coffee, and a mango Alfonso. They're all excellent, and so there's a few out front to sample, and Chef right now is using the raspberry one.
So those are more concentrated than a regular, just fresh fruit puree.
Yes, it's really strong. They're in essence made to enhance the flavor of the natural fruit. However, in comparison to, say, anybody that's familiar with our gelato products, the Pastry Select line was made with a lower acidity so that it can be combined into creams and other applications with a little bit more ease, and it has a really, really intense but refined flavor to it.
So what you add first is the puree, the sugar, and the compound in one pan. You warm this to dissolve the sugar. So if you want to do this part, I know it's a small quantity. If you want to do this in a microwave, because you do small quantity, you can do it also. So chef's going to wash this. On my left here, what I have here, the other side, is the sugar, agar-agar, and locust vent gum. So you dissolve this with the water, and you bring to boil for 2-3 minutes. When it becomes a little bit thicker, at this point we can mix with the puree here and the compound, the sugar a little bit. And at this point we put this on a squeeze bottle, and we're going to drop those pearls, the liquid, directly on the oil. So the oil been in a cooler 24 hours, you put oil in a cooler, couple day in advance. It's better you put the oil in the cooler because the pearl, the syrup, the base right now is hot. So if you put in a warm oil, it's not going to set. So usually what we did 10 minutes ago, we put the oil in the freezer, actually, to chill the oil. And when you make more and more, let me put this to warm up. When you see the pearl himself doesn't set more, of course you have 2 containers of oil, and you strain the pearl, that's what we're going to do, and you put the other one back in a blast freezer. Or outside, let's go put this way. Right now it's perfect. And you go like this. So, example, we make those pearls we don't make here, I bring the pearl with me. So it's also another way where I can tell you, this way you can travel. So we make, it was 6 kilos of pearl. So think about it, it was a lot. And we travel, we crawl back.
I can't believe he didn't go, that he passed through customs with all the...
he never gets stopped. This is the second time he does it. And
I only bring
100 full.
Kilo with me of food, so, you know? And I say, I have nothing to declare, correct? And no, of course.
We
they see me pushing a big car, you know, like, okay.
We organize with chocolate, with samples, with helpers, and here he comes in with his whole everything ready to go.
But I was smart.
Very smart.
I mean, there are a lot of French people in Canada, you know?
Is that a sign of smartness?
So.
Sorry, your French is over there.
Dissolve your agar-agar and locust gum and a coal before you start to warm everything, okay? Do this first.
So I think it's time to, while we look at Chef preparing that, maybe pass around those alunga that's waiting for us to try.
So it's a very small recipe. Of course, when you do this, I have a very precise small scale, because sometimes you need 1.5, 1.4 grams. So of course, if you scale those big recipe or small recipe on a normal scale, they may work, but you know. So this is going to come a little bit like I don't want to say like a jam, but a very a paste almost. So the oil is in the cooler, correct? So I want us, we find a clear container. We recommend to have a bigger container. That is the most bigger container I can find here. But usually, you know the Cambro plastic like this? That's what I recommend, something like this. So actually what it does when the pearl go to the oil, to the bottom, that is what you have the time to set. So if it's dropping too fast because you pour too fast, chef, you can mix, you will see. It's not going to be set. And if you, of course, with a squeeze bottom like this, if you go too fast, you will see, it doesn't have time to set. So when you pick up with a spoon or a tammy, they all stick together. So if it's the first time, go slow, try to understand the process, watch some video again, if you're not sure what you're doing, and it will come very easy. So you can see, so it's boiling right now, 2-3 minutes like this, because it's a small recipe, we're going to 1 minute is enough. We mix together here. So this process, you will see when it's cold, it's nothing you can do about it. It's not like it's irreversible. So you pretty much have to go, if you make it, like the other day, we make 6 kilos. At one point, we have 4 chefs, and we'll take a large container and we go for. Because we know at one point you're going to be pretty much, you're going to see. So if you get to the point where it's too hard, what you can do with this? You can always put in a robot coupe. Again, you cannot reuse to do this process, but at least what you can do, you can use a robot coupe and make a jam, put in a cup or something like this, okay? All right, chef, let's go mix here. Let me take everything. Do they want to see this? They don't want to see that. I don't know, correct? Why don't you tell him? He doesn't know, it's his first show. Do you think it's funny, huh? He like what I say. But anyway, the whisk. Thank you, chef. You need this, otherwise, try to be okay. Now, going to that here on the marble. So you can wait maybe 10 minutes if you're not in a rush. Today we're not in a rush, but we have a schedule. So we pretty much have to do, because the oil is cold, so it's okay because this is pretty hot right now. If you want to know, I would say it's about 65 to 70 degrees. So the oil at one point is going to come back to warm temperature very quickly. So you, like I told you earlier, you may have to have another second oil and change over. Otherwise. So I don't put any pressure on a squeeze bottom right now. If you put a pressure, it of course going to be faster. And you can see how fast it goes. And like I told you, you need to have the container tall enough so for them to be able to set quickly.
Looks so pretty. Six kilos of those?
Yes. It took us an hour and 50 minutes, if you want to know exactly, four chefs. But two chefs was doing this, and two was rotation with the oil and take away from the oil. Usually what I do, I transport in the oil, the same oil, and after what we did, when here yesterday, we rinse under the water to remove the oil. That's it. If you want to put a little bit of simple syrup or other things like this, but that's it.
So to keep it, you leave it in the oil and you rinse it just before serving?
Yes.
Like just before?
We rinse yesterday. When they rinse, they okay. It's just for transportation. It's better if you if you have a little bit of oil so they don't stick. And those was...
And those pearls sitting in oil, how long can you leave them?
I would say you can do a week, but after a week, the pearl is going to be start a little bit thicker and thicker. So you change a little bit the thickness. The question is, why would you need to have the pearls made a week in advance? So the question is, you need to answer those questions to yourself for your business or for why you want to do this. For me, we did 2 days ago, so I traveled 2 days ago. So now they were made on which today?
Today's
Wednesday.
Wednesday. So we made those
Monday.
On Monday. All right, so you can see the way they are. So of course you have some small, some different size. It's just the way how the chef will...
How hard you press.
And because right now I don't press at all. What it is because it's hot, so he will, by himself, you know, it's coming very fast. So you see, it's not complicated to make a caviar. And it's you can use them different. I saw people using in a cake, an entremet, as a layer, or actually to put inside the mousse. So if you do a vanilla mousse, or a passion fruit, because passion fruit with raspberry go well, to my test. So you make a passion fruit, and you mix together, you make a layer. So when people cut, they see the small pearl like this, and it could be interesting. I mean, to go fishing, you need something to be longer, you know? Or the best is actually just to have another container, and you pass everything. So to make sure the wood spatula, no. Also, what is nice to do is, there's too much oil. No, it's okay, come here. Tu l'amènes? So usually you take a spatula and you look like this, and you make sure they don't stick together. You can see that. So you just gently turn the spatula like this. They're pretty much ready. Le chinois, bah, c'est bon. So you can save the oil, of course, for as many times you need it. You don't use the oil to fry canola, correct? Cannoli, like yesterday we did. Yesterday was my first time. A friend of mine, we went to do some cannoli. So anyway. You can see the way they're beautiful. So you can cravat like this because you have the oil. So just you don't need much oil. That is enough. Seal or plastic container you put in the fridge. You have a mise en place. And as you need for the service, you take another small passet, whatever you call this, and under the water, and that's it. Okay? I leave here. You can see. So we can put the... Right now we're going to finish the chocolate mousse. So you remember?
How chocolate? Did you find El Lunga? Was it good? Sorry, chef.
It's okay. So we're going to whip the cream to add to the ganache, because it's what it is, pretty much. We're back on page 6. Any question the way we did the caviar? No? Okay. The only thing I say, canola oil, correct? I have tendency to work the best for us.
And it should always be cold when you put it in.
Yes. The best is to keep your oil in a cooler or in a freezer, that's it. And when you get warm, because you make a big production, cool down the oil, that's it. So the temperature of the chocolate, chef, look the temperature for us, it's going to tell us. Right now it's 29, it's a little bit warm. I don't know, y a des glaçons? We can put this quickly, just put 2 minutes in a cooler to cool down the temperature. You know, it's nothing wrong with this, but what I mean is if you have the ganache is too hot and the cream, the good thing is cold, it comes right from the fridge, so. Otherwise, it's going to be very soupy, you know.
So it started to pass around the Ocoa, the 70% that Chef Monte is using right now. So you get to try it too.
The next recipe, we're going to go on page 7. And we're going to do the crispy chocolate raspberry air cake. So the way we're going to make this, everything is done on a robot coupe. I like the robot coupe, it's easy because you get a great emulsion on this and it's an easy way to make it. If you don't have a robot coupe, you can use a kitchenette, you're fine. If you don't have a kitchenette, you can use a whisk. If you don't have a whisk, you go buy one.
Don't we like you?
Okay. But pretty much it's easy. I like because, yes. Soft peak. Eh? I'll put this here in case. So right now the chef, I believe, is melting the chocolate, correct? Okay. So one thing I learned from the robot coupe, you put this first. Because if you put all your ingredients here and you press, this comes to the top, everything is leaking, correct? So we put this directly to the robot coupe. And when I tell you put everything, is the way it comes. Whatever you scale, us, we scale everything a few days ago, except the milk, the liquid first. Eggs. Sugar, flour. Salt.
So after the Ocoa, we're passing it around the Inaya. So you're going to taste the difference. Again, the Inaya has only 65%, so it's sweeter, but it has more cocoa solids and less cocoa butter, so it's actually stronger in chocolate. But it has a really nice flavor. I like that one.
So what you see right now on the video is a TV screen is a raspberry flavor, the compound. So you get the chocolate raspberry. The cake is cooked in a microwave. So right now the only thing at the part I'm missing from here is the chocolate, melting chocolate. So if you have a melter like we have here, of course it's easy. I should tell the chef to take from here, but I want him to do the hard way, you know. No, I'm not testing. What you need is a coffee cup like this. If you don't have this, you can try other thing, but they don't work very well, the best also. So whatever works for you. So I recommend you get this. With the yesterday, thank you, chef. You make a, what do you call this?
Skewer.
Skewer, whatever. You make a few holes, okay? Without punching yourself. That's it. You need, of course, one of those beautiful air gun, and because we're going to put the mix inside. Then after we're putting three of those. So it depends the size, but most of the time we figure out 2 days ago two was not enough. And so we put three. You may say, how much did I put inside? I can tell you this because in Charlotte, Prigel America, we start to sell this website. So for safety, what they did here, the purpose of this on the bottom is actually if you put too much air pressure like this, what happened here, this part will come around here. So this part will never explode to you. That is what they told us. I mean, maybe you may need to put 10, so you really have to push the lock. So, almost ready? Yeah, but chocolate. So I guess we have a microwave that doesn't melt. Because, you know, the microwave is cold also, you know, he doesn't like the cold weather here. I'm not going to say the chocolate doesn't want to melt. But anyway, why don't you take the chocolate from here, chef? I believe at this point, 50 gram, we know what is 50 gram. Let me show you what is 50 gram. How much do you need, 50? 100. Look, let me show you 100 gram. I'm going to tell you exactly what it is. I believe we know that, correct? So, 25, 75, and 100. I believe you can do that in cup, and, correct? So 100 gram. But I'm going to demonstrate his work. You want me to scale, to show you? I'm right, because I do. Anyway. That is the beauty when you do demo, you know, is you do life, you know? You gotta go with the flow. So. You have a Marie's, chef? Thank you. You scrape the side. Sometimes you have a flower on a corner. That is normal. So I told you, you better to have a robot coupe. If you don't have one, you know where to get one. That's it. Oh, almost, huh? You see that? Too close, huh? So, it's very liquid. To be safe, also is a line right here.
So what's the temperature on that? That's not really warm. It's just
No, it's not warm at all. It's no temperature, actually. It's cold.
It's just
right now.
The chocolate is melted, but that's
it. It's liquid. So like I said earlier, you have a line. You technically, you're not supposed to pass the line. The nozzle is not a matter. The nozzle, they sell this with different nozzle, whatever come up. And now we're going to put after putting the gas, you put in a fridge for 30 minutes. Okay? At least 30 minutes. We're going to finish we're going to put in a cooler just for a few minutes. We're going to finish the mousse. Temperature is now? Temperature is 20. Put a little bit of whipped cream first. I like a whisk better myself.
How would you explain the difference in texture when you make it more like a crémeux, like the first mousse, and when you make it like that?
But that is a mousse, it's not a crémeux.
Yeah, so like what's the difference in texture on a crémeux? Like in
a crémeux is cooked, you know, it's like a, you have yolks and you have eggs technically. So that is it's more light. A crémeux would be more heavy. It's good also sometimes people, chef, will take the crémeux and put in a icy gun and create also something like this. For the restaurant business, like example, I used to long time ago, you know, when I was young, you know, but when I work at the Greenbrier, example, I was doing a sugar sphere, blow a sugar sphere and sugar, empty the inside, and after put this inside. So take the crémeux, make a salty caramel crémeux, and after put in an icy gun and spray inside, and you can serve on a. I used to make alzenot d'acquoise or something like this. So. Plus all the gelato inside. So you have a different texture, you know? So you can use one recipe, one ingredient for what you make, and sometimes you twist a little bit the version, or you twist your whatever is your vision is, and it's nice. So the difference between a mousse is more light. Mousse is technically also a pâte à bombe sometimes inside. Pâte à bombe is, you know, York sugar cooked on a stove. This one doesn't have it. And also some of the mousse are whipped. This one is not. So after, it's up to you. Whatever the flavor, whatever the consistency you try to obtain. Usually the cream, I use 35%. I don't know, I didn't look yesterday the percentage of the fat, but if you have 35-36%, because this would be a factor for your mousse, depend the fat also. You can get this from the company, you get the chocolate, they will tell you the contain of cocoa butter, so that can affect also your mousse. So if you make this mousse, you can make, so here we have the mousse. We pretty much also use the mousse we make this morning. Pretty much the same consistency. This one is a little bit, we never put this mousse in a cooler. We left at the room temperature. So that's what I'm going to do. If you make this mousse and put between sponge or you want to do a frame, also you can do it because we put a little bit of gelatin, if you remember. So like this, if you cut a frame individual cake with maybe a layer of pâte de fruits or a layer of vanilla, crémeux, thing like this, it's perfect also.
So would it have been too hard to pipe if you had put it in the fridge earlier?
Yes. If you put it in a cooler like this and you want to use tomorrow, no, it's not going to be it's not going to be good. So you better to finish your cake boiled the way you want, but bring the cake to room temperature for at least 10, 15 minutes so at least it's not too cold. So what I'm going to do is put the caviar on the side. Because on the center, what I'm going to do is put the mousse. I don't think so you need too much caviar anyway, because the flavor is pretty strong. So if you want to do a layer, I looked the one they did this morning. some a little bit too much caviar, because I didn't watch the student doing this very well. So I look around and, I turn around and I see some a little bit too much, but the flavor with a raspberry and chocolate is pretty much what you need. So the next, Ronnie, the next recipe will be the, we're going to actually to cook the sponge. To show you this. A little bit, so I don't use the tips, I just want a drop on the center like this. De quoi? Ah oui, il peut, s'il veut. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, so I'm going to cook right now the, so if you want to, no, you can leave this here. That's, il y a un autre disque qui va dessus. So right here, we're going to, when you spray like this, always put the foam down, so like this, and if you don't have everything inside, what you usually do, you press like this, everything going down this way. So right now everything went back down below. So you like this, you get everything back quickly. So I put a little bit inside, 45 seconds, chef. So after it's up to you, in a sense, I don't know your microwave, I don't know the what, but we cook one, we see if it was too much or not. This one yesterday worked very well, this morning 45 seconds, and that's it.
So I promised that when Francesco came back from the kitchen, I was gonna introduce him. So Francesco Battaglia is one of our Cacao Barry promoters here in town as well. And he's been helping out the whole day, hiding in the background. So it's nice to have him in the front. Thank you.
So a recipe like this will give you about 10 cups like this. And each cup, you should be able, the way we're going to cut, you should get 7 portions. Because I just need one in the center, you will see. So you get 7 cake. 7 variant, I'm sorry. So this one was just cooked right now. Usually what you do, you flip upside down right away, okay? And you keep in a cooler like this. If you want, you can freeze also. Some people will tell you, no, it's not, at the end of the day, it's how you want to organize yourself, how can you organize yourself with the equipment you have in your shop or store or restaurant, whatever you have it. So usually we at least spend a couple hours in a cooler, if it's not in a freezer. But this one to show you also, if you have to use right away, because you want to use right away, because the dessert need something warm, because right now the temperature is pretty warm, you can do that. You can see all the nice bubble inside. That's it. Okay. One of the desserts I did also a couple months ago for a magazine, I talked some of the sponge like this, put in oven, or these are something where you can dry. I don't know if you, yes. Are you sure? Dehydrator? Yeah. So you can do this, but you know, those machines are expensive. Otherwise, you put in oven for 200, and this part here become very dry. But when you crunch, when you eat with your mouth, it's almost become like a powder. So what I did, I dust with gold, and I called the nugget gold nugget verrine. It's one of the verrine I did a couple months ago for a magazine in the US. So, okay, so upside down. The reason why you put upside down is pretty much like the panettone, because you don't want to compress back the sponge. You want the sponge to be light as possible. So, I don't know if we have some ready, because we make some in advance. So the next step here, we're going to do the crumble. If you want to start to bring the verrine, are they ready? We can start to, or you want to wait to finish? No, we're going to start to pass the verrine. And I'm going to finish the crumble. Then after, the last part will be the cotton candy. So the verrine is basic crumble. It's nothing, only cube the butter. So I put all the dry. The only thing I did a little bit different on this crumble, I put some cocoa nib inside. Cocoa nib, everybody knows what it is, correct? Very strong flavor of chocolate. If your cocoa nib is too big, most of the time it is, for what you need, I use a coffee grinder, grind a little bit. If you want a little bit something smoky or something more dry, you can put in oven and continue to dry to make it more harder. And also, I done also in the past to infuse the cocoa nib to smoke also with different flavor. So like this, you get a different flavor like wood also in your cocoa nib. I mean, there's so many things you can do with this. I just give you a few tips. Correct? Correct.
Correct. I'm trying to tweet you.
Please tweet me. She
Sorry.
Liked this.
Not focusing on my cocoa nibs.
She wants to make sure the order go out tonight. Because the customer is not happy about it.
I have all the important ones here, right?
So give you a little bit the chocolate peanut crumble. This one is you can do with salted or unsalted butter if you wanna depend what you have. I put almond flour, hazelnut. I like the combination also of hazelnut and almond. Sometimes is your almond or hazelnut also are too dry, not enough dry. What you can do is, and you know that because we're supposed to preserve the almond flour in a freezer, technically, so they don't get bad. So at this point, what you take, when you make your mise en place once a week or once a month, you take a 10-sheet pan, you put your almond flour or hazelnut flour in a sheet pan, you put it in oven at 200 degrees, and you put this for 2 hours. So like this, you remove all the moisture. And that will help for you to get a sponge if you make dacquoise or if you make a thing like this, to get not so much mushy or saggy thing like this, whatever you call. So that also is a tip. On this recipe, what we did is we put also the Prigel traditional paste. So it's a different product than the peanut crunchy, the one I used early for the paste, for the crème, the second recipe we did. Butter, cube, you know that, correct? If you don't want to do cube, usually I keep my butter until I use or make the crumble in a freezer or at least a cooler. So like this is. Like we talked earlier when I start to do this, I like the texture, so I like my crumble crunchy. It doesn't have a spoon, Luca, for some reason. But I'm going to also to show you another tips, what is great to use. I use a lot of Micrio. So when you're done with your any crumble or sweet dough, tart shell you're making, right when they come from the oven, again, your magic tool, the passette, whatever you call, and you spray right from when the crumble come from the oven or the tart shell, and you spray on the top like this. So the mikrio is going to melt right away on top of your crumble, but that will preserve also, right now it's not too much an issue here, but the moisture, because I guess the moisture is not the problem today, but in July, August, when you have a lot of moisture, it prevents to not have your crumble or sweet dough to become saggy. So it's almost a protection. You know, a long time ago, we used to take the tart shell and spray with a chocolate or thing like this, but that is pretty much your coating, your base.
So mikrio, I think most of you are familiar with mikrio, but it's cocoa butter in powdered form. So it comes in sprinkled bottles, so it's really easy and convenient to use. You can just put it on top of your tart shell or whatever you're using. It's also really good in savory application to use when you cook meat or fish or vegetables. It keeps the flavor and moisture inside whatever you cook, and it's really delicious.
So you can tell, they bring me the small machine they can find, okay? Sometimes you got to look inside because it's pretty deep over there. I don't know if you can see with the video, but it's pretty... And I'm going to show you what I did for this. I use magic sugar, and I use the five-star line, the compound. So the compound and the magic sugar melt together, in a sense, melt. Mix together, it become like a paste. Of course, you need to use glove because that is a gel almost, and the sugar. So what I did, actually, on your recipe on page 4, you only have 200 grams of sugar and 20 grams of five-star raspberry compound. You can do this with any other compound, any other flavor, we have it. If not, because you can do passion fruit, coconut, so imagine how now you can be creative and use a different flavor. But also, I put 30% of magic sugar, what is isomalt. So, let's go say 60 grams of 70 grams of sugar and 30 the isomalt, the magic sugar. I have one bag here. If you want, we can open this. You can see the isomalt. Isomalt also is what we're using to make a sugar piece. You know, pretty much nobody anymore using real sugar. So that is also when you have a lot of moisture to prevent to the moisture. And very thin. I don't know how many of you saw the one from Prigel, but it's very nice. As a sugar, if you done in the past, or if you do sugar piece, there's a lot of isomalt in the market, as you know. One become yellow, one is become green. If you don't know the name, I'm not going to tell you, but anyway. The good thing with this one, when you want a clear sugar, it stay clear. So the reason why it's become white, or it become a yellow, or it turn to a green, is because also people sometimes cook too high, or don't cook with enough water. So if you cook with water, this one will absorb up to 20% of water, and after you cooking, you evaporate the water. So we have a beautiful class facility. Each time, every year, I bring a good friend of mine. His name is Laurent Branlard. He's a two-time world championship. I don't know if you know this guy. I don't know if we can look, because I believe I saw in a video from Prigel the sugar piece he made. The last one was with the apple, thing like this. I mean, we post a lot of pictures. He's, for me, one of the top in the country, and a good friend of mine. He's not afraid to give to give you an idea. In 3 days, we teach a class, like Laurent Branlard. He's going to show you probably 20 ways. He's going to give you 20 formula to create or to use a magic sugar. So he's not afraid to give you all the technique. Because to pass to somebody something, that is the easy way. I will tell you this. To give you a recipe is the easy way. For you to replicate at the same level, or even better than the person who's been doing for 20 years, that is difficult. And that is, I believe, you know, us, we humble as a chef to pass, to share knowledge, but after it's up to you to go home, practice, and become better.
So how did you find the dessert? It's pretty good.
So you can taste the flavor from the... I'm looking for the name. The cotton candy. If you taste first by himself, it's very interesting because you really taste the flavor of the raspberry. And it's, you can do this just individual or wrap with a... Maybe it could be also something on a stick, like those new pop cake today, what they call, and you can wrap this around. So it could be also very interesting.
So the video that Chef was mentioning just now are available on our YouTube channel, so you can find that through the Prejal Canada or Prejal America website. And there's a lot of different videos from gelato making to pastry and sugar sculptures and the like.
So then I will say the same. If you go in on Cake au Barry and look on our website as well, you're going to find a lot of videos, explanations on how to crystallize chocolate, how to different recipes, etc. It's so actually a nice partnership with Prejal. We're both similar in many ways. We also have a chocolate academy in Montreal. They have one school here, while we have ours in Montreal, with classes for professionals.
But the good thing I would say, and I share this always with Jérôme, I don't know if you know Jérôme Landrieux, who's a corporate pastry chef for Cacao Barry in Chicago. We make sure we never bring the same chef because we don't like to compete against each other. It doesn't make sense. Example, Jérôme teach dessert buffet pastry, but he doesn't do this at his academy, so he only teach pastry for us in Prejal. And the chef we bring during the year, 2015, they are not the same. If by mistake or happiness they are the same chef, we make sure one chef in Cacao Barry will teach ganache and bonbon, and us he will teach pastry or something different. So like this, we don't have to worry about competition.
Yeah.
And repeating the same thing. So you can tell the way it is. I like this one is more light, like a very thin crumble. If I want to make a big piece, what I would just do is almost overcook, mix a little longer, then it becomes a bigger piece, and that's it. But I like the powder the way it is. So this recipe was pretty made for this application. If you want a little bit the piece bigger, I would tell you to add probably maybe 10% of fat inside. Okay. Otherwise, it's going to be always like in powder like this. But that is the texture I was looking for. So the chef is going to cook this very quickly. See, he put an oven. Then he's giving me back right away. See, it's amazing. So he comes right from the oven right here, like I told you earlier. And
passing by the outside minus 25 to get cooled down.
And right away, you take the, of course it's cold. I mean, it's warm, but it's not going to melt. But if you come right from the oven, when you spray like this, it disappears. It becomes shiny, okay?
But so that's the mikri or cocoa powder again.
That is the mikri, what I'm talking about. And that give you're able to preserve a product longer and to get a better crunchiness. It doesn't affect the flavor at all, unless you put too much, but, okay? So the next part is the next recipe, the raspberry cotton candy. Scissor. What we need is maybe a bigger bowl. No bigger bowl? It's okay. We make up on chef, so stay here. So, like I told you earlier, 70% sugar, 30% magic sugar. You take the compound. You can do that by hand. Or, of course, if you make a big production, use the kitchenette. Of course, like I told you earlier, make sure you're using some glove. So it's a little bit of process to do this. It doesn't take much time. You can it look like a sandy. You can see that. You can see enough, or do you want to come closer? You can come closer. I don't bite.
Be careful.
But anyway, and there's two ways you can put. You can put an oven. Overnight is the best. You know, 200 degrees, 180. So, you have a sheet pan, please. You may have some piece look like a chunk because, of course, it's sugar. So when you put like this, and you put this in oven, maybe this part here will come together. Don't worry about it because, of course, the sugar is going to recrystallize. It's not an issue. Don't forget you have sugar and also you have isomalt, magic sugar. See, you have a piece here, it's not dissolved, so if you do a little bit longer, it will. Put this on oven, 200 degrees max, 180 overnight, the next day, RoboCoop. If you don't have a RoboCoop, at least coffee grinder, and that's it. After the chef is going to show you the result. So you can come closer here. So we have also Appreciate America, a smaller cotton candy. Very small, like you know, the one you buy at Walmart, Target. I don't know if you're familiar with this. It doesn't work good, I will tell you this. So you can say, how can I make with a big machine like this? Well, they actually, it's other company, if you look on the website, who's doing this. But the one from Target to Walmart is not strong enough in a sense, it's not warm enough. It doesn't get melting enough faster. So
did I understand right that you sell those small machines as well?
No, we do not.
No. Okay.
I just inform you, don't jump and just buy the one you see at $40 and you're happy because you're going to try it, it's not going to work. So just invest a little bit more money, maybe 150, whatever. But so it's coming. All right, so you have a spoon? Okay.
Training your muscles there.
No, I just. Start to fly.
Feel like a kid.
Ça vole, hein? All right.
So would you do that ahead of time, or would you do that, or if you had a restaurant and had a little machine like that, would you do that to order? Would you do that to order, or would you do it ahead of time?
No, you can do that at the time. We did, I can tell you right now, we did those like 2 hours in advance, and they were fine. Then you know the comes up?
You want me to? I want it.
Donne-moi quelque chose.
Tear a little piece away.
Une spatule, un fouet. Wow, look at that. The one is on a spatula.
Oh, wow. Look
anyway.
That's pretty.
Hey, I believe you gain the, what we call in French, the barba papa, and you get also the spatula. You can keep the spatula. It's a gift from the school.
Won't be welcome back here again.
Anyway, we did this 2 hours early during before the lunch. Again, the reason why you can make 2 hours before is why? Because we have isomalt inside. We have not just sugar. And we are not in July. So in July, August, I believe you have more moisture than right now. I don't know. Is anybody knows what is the moisture right now? I guarantee you don't have more than 25, correct? Maybe 30, 33, 35. So it's actually pretty good. Compared then if you are in Miami, 110%, 100% moisture, and it becomes soggy. So if you want to make this in advance and you don't know how to keep for at least a couple hours, you get some limestone, okay? Put in a plastic container, put a parchment paper, and that, or gel. Also, sometimes you can get gel. I don't know, if, whatever you can get here in Canada. But limestone or Jellica gel is called. And you put this parchment paper, and you put your cotton candy in a box, and as you need, you put a piece, that's it. So, to finish the verrine, because I guess you already eat the verrine, I'm not finished yet. So, what I have here is the sponge. So, a nice piece of sponge on the center. But first, I like to do with the spoon, chef. A spoon. We have a hard time to find a spoon at the school, for some reason. There we go. Plastic spoon. So, the crumble is here. You see, I don't like too much big piece like this, because the purpose is to have a very tiny like this. I put some on top. Actually, it was a disc, a second disc of chocolate here.
So that's also milk?
Yes, the same. Now, if you want to alter it, you can do one milk, one dark if you want. And I like because you can see the different layer when you put the crumble on the top. The rest, la mousse au chocolat là. Putain, c'est dommage. Non, mais c'est jamais.
C'est pas grave.
So, I put a little bit. Papa? Mm-hmm. Where's the framboise, the CG? So when you make this, try to give it some height, you know?
It looks very pretty.
And what I have here is a little bit of dry raspberry on top. That's it. So we can open the discussion if it's about the dessert. If somebody have a question or about the recipe, or we need to talk about something else. I'll just leave a few like this so you understand and you can see better. We can actually put this here, so it will look much better.
Does anybody have a question? No? You're all going to go back home and do this? Yes? Maybe. Maybe. When the inspiration comes. It's very good.
But pretty much inspiration came from this one, what we did, I believe it's a year ago, actually. I don't know if you saw that on our website. That was actually a frozen gelato in the center, green tea. The rest I don't remember too much. It's too old, but something like this. Anyway, we're going to take a 5 minute, 10 minute break to set up for the next demonstration. So if you need to see your text, like Luca, or make a phone call, please enjoy. And we will see you in 10 minutes.
I think we have a little bit of coffee out there, too.
We have coffee, like water, and if we have more cup if you need to. Thank you very much.
Yes. Okay. Let me introduce myself and then come and say hello.
the recipe books?
Yes.
Yeah,
we can definitely.
Nice to meet
amateurs de chocolat, ce sont vraiment trois chocolats sublimes, super, plein de goût, plein de saveurs. On est en train vraiment de se défouler avec ces trois chocolats. Et bon, j'ai fait quelques créations, autant dans des verrines, pâtisserie, desserts sur assiette et bonbons bien sûr. Et je dois dire que c'était fabuleux.
Aujourd'hui, on a eu un atelier de création avec nos ambassadeurs chefs du Québec et on leur a demandé de développer des recettes à partir de notre nouvelle gamme de chocolat Q Fermentation. Ils ont fait ça avec brio, c'était délicieux.
Yo pienso que quizá hemos pasado, pasemos de una de un concepto más barroco, complejidad de sabores, ¿no? A una cosa más minimalista, más concreta. Es un chocolate con mucha capacidad de jugar, de adaptarse, una cobertura muy, con mucho carácter. Si se puede llegar a eso, se pueden hacer muchas cosas más. Ese es un primer paso, creo, de una evolución a la hora de hacer chocolate. Radicalidad, evolución y potencia. Queremos contar historias, ¿no? Y esta es una historia muy bonita.
Je vous souhaite la bienvenue à la Guilde Culinaire pour le lancement officiel des trois nouveaux produits d'une fermentation optimisée des trois produits Alunga, Inaya et Okoa. En tant qu'ambassadeur, comme vous le savez, de Cacao Barry, vous êtes les premiers à travailler ce produit. Nous allons travailler en atelier. On vous demandera de développer un certain nombre de recettes.
Le rhum blanc peut aller, on se rend compte que le rhum ambré, le rhum brun, le rhum bio, ça va très très bien. Le whisky, c'est l'alcool qui va par excellence avec le cacao. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'il y a maltage et à la même étape de l'élaboration.
Je dis toujours que Cacao Barry est le trait d'union entre le fermier, le planteur et le maître chocolatier qui crée ses douceurs et qui est plein de créativité. Alors évidemment, ces produits ont été construits, assemblés, décidés avec les fermiers, avec les planteurs de cacao, en fusion avec les artisans chocolatiers.
Chocolat façon After Eight avec un petit sablé breton et une ganache chocolat menthe et un espumage chocolat au lait. On se fait une verrine avec un crumble chocolat, compoté de cerises, mousse chocolat et émulsion vanille. Et on se fait un dessert à l'assiette avec une anglaise au thé du Labrador, une meringue suisse à l'érable et on va normalement faire un petit croustillant chocolat feuilletine.
Alors bonjour, je m'appelle Christophe Morel.
Alors Jonathan Garnier, chef propriétaire de la Guilde Culinaire à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Olivier Potier.
Bonjour, mon nom c'est Marc Yekio, je suis au Québec depuis 37 ans et je suis propriétaire des pâtisseries Marius et Fanny.
Bonjour, Ludovic Fraisse, chef chocolatier pour Chocolat Privilège à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Nicolas Duterre, donc je suis chef pâtissier.
Bonjour, mon nom est Nancy Sanson, je suis enseignante à l'école d'hôtellerie à Trois-Rivières et j'ai une chocolaterie à Trois-Rivières également.
Amateurs de chocolat, ce sont vraiment trois chocolats sublimes, superbes, plein de goût, plein de saveurs. On est en train vraiment de se défouler avec ces trois chocolats. Et bon, j'ai fait quelques créations, autant dans des verrines, pâtisseries, desserts sur assiette et bonbons bien sûr. Je dois dire que c'était fabuleux.
Aujourd'hui, on a eu un atelier de création avec nos ambassadeurs chefs du Québec et on leur a demandé de développer des recettes à partir de notre nouvelle gamme de chocolat Q Fermentation Ils ont fait ça avec brio, c'était délicieux.
Yo pienso que quizá hemos pasado, pasemos de una de un concepto más barroco, complejidad de sabores, ¿no? A una cosa más minimalista, más concreta. Es un chuete con mucha capacidad de jugar, de adaptarse, una cobertura muy, con mucho carácter. Si se puede llegar a eso, se pueden hacer muchas cosas más. Ese es un primer paso, creo, de una evolución a la hora de hacer chocolate. Radicalidad, evolución y potencia. Queremos contar historias, ¿no? Y esta es una historia muy bonita.
Thank you. Bonjour.
Alors, je vous souhaite la bienvenue à la Guilde Culinaire pour le lancement officiel des trois nouveaux produits d'une fermentation optimisée des trois produits Alunga, Inaya et Okoa. En tant qu'ambassadeur, comme vous le savez, de Cacao Barry, vous êtes les premiers à travailler ce produit. Nous avons travaillé en atelier. On vous demandera de développer un certain nombre de recettes.
Le rhum blanc peut aller. On se rend compte que le rhum ambré, le rhum brun, le rhum bio, ça va très très bien. Le whisky, c'est l'alcool qui va par excellence avec le cacao. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'il y a maltage et à la même étape de l'élaboration.
Je dis toujours que Cacao Barry est le trait d'union entre le fermier, le planteur et le maître chocolatier qui crée ses douceurs et qui est plein de créativité. Alors évidemment, ces produits ont été construits, assemblés, décidés avec les fermiers, avec les planteurs de cacao, en fusion avec les artisans chocolatiers.
Chocolat façon After Eight avec un petit sablé breton et une ganache chocolat menthe et un espumage chocolat au lait. On se fait une verrine avec un crumble chocolat, compoté de cerises, mousse chocolat et émulsion vanille. Et on se fait un dessert à l'assiette avec une anglaise au thé du Labrador, une meringue suisse à l'érable et on va normalement faire un petit croustillant chocolat feuilleting.
Alors bonjour, je m'appelle Christophe Morel.
Alors Jonathan Garnier, chef propriétaire de la Guilde Culinaire à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Olivier Potier.
Alors bonjour, mon nom c'est Marc Equio, je suis au Québec depuis 37 ans et je suis propriétaire des pâtisseries Marius et Fanny.
Bonjour, Ludovic Fraisse, chef chocolatier pour Chocolat Privilège à Montréal.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Nicolas Duterre, donc je suis chef pâtissier.
Bonjour, mon nom est Nancy Sanson, je suis enseignante à l'école d'hôtellerie à Trois-Rivières et j'ai une chocolaterie à Trois-Rivières également.
Amateurs de chocolat, ce sont vraiment trois chocolats sublimes, superbes, plein de goût, plein de saveurs. On est en train vraiment de se défouler avec ces trois chocolats. Et bon, j'ai fait quelques créations, autant dans des verrines, pâtisseries, desserts sur assiette.
Give me the power. There we go.
Je veux dire que c'était fabuleux.
Thanks for the break. The coffee was good. So, the next one, I did. See, now I have two chefs. Wow. See that? One on my left, one on my right. It's fantastic. It's so well organized. So, what we're going to do is we're going to make a very simple classic bonbon. Okay? We're going to use the
puree from Key Lime Puree. Et on leur a demandé de développer
water,
des recettes
fresh
à partir
oranges.
De notre nouvelle gamme
we
de
squeeze
chocolat
on this recipe the fresh oranges. If you don't like to squeeze those and you want to use the can, whatever, or the puree, If you want to use puree, it's fine. Just make sure you don't get too much of the pulp. So you may need to use the chinois to remove all the pulp. Glucose, sugar, pectin, again. What we put on this pâte de fruits, because it is like a gelée, pâte de fruits, similar again. I put something is called Fiber Plus. You have Fiber Plus here?
We do have Fiber Plus.
So, what is a Fiber Plus?
Fiber Plus is actually an alimentary fiber. It's inulin, and it's derived from chicory root. So, in pastry applications, and especially in gelato applications, such as dairy-free sorbetti that don't have a lot of natural fiber to them, such as lemon or any of your other citruses, it provides a lot of structure and substance to the gelato, increasing the solids so you can actually extend the shelf life and have a better texture to your gelato in general.
So I found out from this using this Fiber Plus, and that is also a course we have in Charlotte, but we're actually making pâte de fruits without the puree. And you can say how. Well, it's very simple. We're using water, sugar, glucose, Fiber Plus, and we're using pectin inside. And we're using what we call the compound only. So I didn't bring any, so I don't know how many of you go to the show. Is the show next week, correct?
The show's in 2 weeks, the Restaurants Canada show.
So if you go to the show, I prep already some pâte de fruits without the puree. So if you go there and you stop by Prigel Booth, you will test the pâte de fruits and you will see. And they can be good as a month, you know, because those was made last week. So you're going to test in 2 weeks. And I mean, you know, it's, a pâte de fruits can be good up to... I don't want to say 6 months, but you know, nothing can go wrong at this. When it's cooked, it's a gem, that's it. So you will test a pâte de fruits without a puree. So that is something we develop for Prigel America. We have a course of confectionery, so we show the two techniques. So here what we have, what we put during the break, we already start to bring to boil the puree, the juice, the glucose, water, the Fiber Plus, pectin and sugar together. The chef already attend the flavor 104. So like this, at the end of 104, you're adding a little bit of here, tartaric acid at the end. If you don't have a tartaric acid, most of the time they sell this in powder. If it's not in powder, you dissolve with a 1-to-1 in the ratio. And if you don't have this, you want to squeeze a lemon juice, something like this. It's perfect, okay? What I bring with me is some sauce, some color. So a little bit, because it's green. So I don't know if you see very well on the TV, but, and this one have a small accident. Don't ask me why. So, a little bit of green and yellow is nice color together. So to try to get the color pretty much of the key lime. So this is what we did after. We pour directly, sir. This way, right here. So, can you tell I was on a TV show before? So what we have here, we cooked the 106. I'm sorry, 104. I just want to make sure you pay attention to what I say. A frame, just a normal, whatever you can do, sheet pan or whatever. Frame is much better. What I did underneath is I put the plastic, okay? So I don't know if you know this, to put a plastic wrap. So you put the plastic wrap on top, you seal the four corner, you take the frame, and you put for 30 seconds in oven at 375. Just you put in oven, you close the door, and what happened? The plastic seal. You know this or no? No? Okay, you can test. So I repeat, how do I do this? You take a frame, you put a plastic wrap on the top, you seal the four corner, you make sure the plastic wrap is on the side, so it's not completely. You take the frame the way it is right here, and you put on a rack with no sheet pan, nothing, just on a rack like this. So the oven is already at 375. You open the door, you put on top, you close the door, you're going to see the plastic wrap is like this, and all of a sudden it becomes like, how you call this, very sifter, clean. Then you put your plastic upside down and you pour the pâte de fruit on top. Otherwise, if you don't want to do this way, you can also do on a sealed pat, okay? The problem with this, if you don't do this way, when you pour your pâte de fruit and the sheet pan is not flat or the sealed pat, whatever, and you see the pâte de fruit, say bye-bye. So that is what you prevent to do the to not have a leak to the pâte de fruit, okay? I don't know if you can see that, but the plastic is still here. Anyway, so what we did here, the pâte de fruit, the frame. Now we're going to make the ganache. So you're going to test the bonbon. I want you to see the and what is behind to test the bonbon. So if you want to do a pâte de fruit, is to bring a texture. If you want to bring a croustillant, also a crunchy, is also a way you can do this. I cut those with the guitar. You know, everybody knows what is a guitar, correct? So otherwise you will cut by hand if you don't have a guitar, what it takes more time. So if you do by hand, of course you can put a crunchy or thing like this. This one, because I did the guitar, I just want you to, the purpose was for me to you to test most the ganache with a gelée, something like this, very simple. If the key lime gelée is not strong enough, what I believe it is for me, but it's not strong enough for you, you can always put the zest. The idea is for me to not put the zest because I don't want to be overpowered to almost kill the ganache. After is all your preference, how you want to balance a bonbon and the texture, okay? So, like I repeat, this one was very simple, a gelée. What we did after, we put, you seal with chocolate, so you temper chocolate, and you seal a very very thin layer. Then after you can also cut with a guitar. So the ganache. So the pâte de fruit we pour, okay? If we put in the plastic. Now we're making the ganache. Like I said earlier, for the I like to make ganache using RoboCoupe. If you don't have RoboCoupe, you can always use hand mixer. Make sure you have one with enough power, otherwise. And it's very good also when you make ganache. We like to always put a chocolate in the bottom, but also in a long container. So like this is no wide, but it's more like a long one. So you can bring the end mixer up and down like this, and you don't bring actually too much bubble to your ganache, or too much air, what is not good for your ganache. This ganache, you see the recipe. Those bonbons was made on Wednesday last week. I didn't put any other product to preserve them, because you know some chef or industry put other product to have a 6 months to, like Jean-Pierre Waibo, a great chocolatier, talk on his book also how to preserve, how to freeze a ganache, you know? So this is not the case for this one. This one is no induction. No, it is. You have a Maryse, chef? If you don't have a Maryse, bring Jocelyne.
Everybody's learning French today.
You know what is a Maryse? Few? Yeah.
At least you kitchen French.
Did you test, do we talk about the chocolate a little bit? No?
Want me to talk about chocolate in this recipe?
Yes. Aqua, did you test during the break or before? Okay.
Yeah, I think we had we passed it around. Did we have enough for everybody to try it? Yeah. Goes far away, so.
So for the chocolate, all the chocolate was on a custom. They keep over there for some reason. You're supposed to laugh, but so thank you. So what we're going to do, we're going to cut those and how many we are, and we have a very tiny piece, correct? See the smile? We enrobed the chocolate with a machine last week. because we have at the school in Charlotte, we have a Bravo machine for this, so of course we did. Otherwise, today I'm going to demonstrate only 6 or 12 to do by hand. If you have to do by hand, it's great. It's great to know how to do it. If you have to make 1,000 pieces a day, good luck. It's not the way to do business today. But you know, a machine is very expensive like this. So yes. Three weeks? The gelée himself are more than 3 weeks.
I mean, as a bonbon?
Yes, as a praliné, 3 weeks, yeah, would be the maximum. Not because the pâte de fruit, but actually because the ganache, correct? Some people, like I said earlier, put sorbitol. I don't know if you know too much about sorbitol. So they put 1% of sorbitol in a ganache. Some chefs put up to 3%. Chef, chocolatier, whatever, the industry. And now you can, if you put sorbitol, you can prolong your chef life. Most if you freeze, you're putting sorbitol inside. Then after, well, you can freeze for a month, 3 months, whatever, as a production you need to do, because let's go say Christmas, Valentine, you're doing 30,000 pieces, and you know you cannot produce 30,000 pieces in a week in advance. So chef or chocolatier will do this, freeze 24 hours in a cooler to bring the ganache to a room temperature. Then from this, they go for shipping. So it's why I don't think so. The purpose of this demonstration today is to go on a deep how to make bonbons like this. I believe Jérôme Academy or Jean-Pierre Wibeau, if you see those books, they explain more this in detail. I want you to test the product fresh by himself, the way it's supposed to be cream and chocolate, and that's it. After, when people put ad after, it's up to your business, and you do the best you can. So, like I told you earlier, I pour the cream right on the top. Usually, I like to leave whatever I do in a robot coupe or in a bowl, I like to leave it like this set for 2 minutes, but I'm going to wait. The reason I do this, I want sometimes the cream can be a little bit too warm, you know? So it's a different way to make a ganache. You have the, if I want to talk about it a little bit different way, you have the chef who will melt chocolate at 50 degrees and cream at 50, mixed together, and the mixer like this. That is one way. You have the chef who will say, you know what, I don't like this technique. I boil the cream, put on the top, robot coupe, this way. Like, I mean, at the end of the day, what again is what you can do and what works the best for you. If it's one way you like better, I believe it becomes with the edge, and I believe the practice and for the business, for what you need to do, is come to up to you to whatever works the best. Sometimes do 50-50, work the best. Sometimes you have a little bit chance to have some piece of chocolate not completely melted. So what you have to do is after take everything, put back in a microwave or in a bain-marie. So if you do microwave or bain-marie, you know the size of the microwave, you know the size of the bain-marie, so you waste some time. You know, it's just up to you. So, oops, make sure you cover the top, always. See that? You see that? Almost catch you, huh? Sometimes pastry is dangerous.
Especially for a camera lens. So Chef Monty is talking about Jérôme Landrieu, which is our technical advisor in Chicago at the Chocolate Academy in Chicago. But we actually have a really good chocolatier in Canada as well, which is Philippe Van Kaisele, who is our director at the Montreal Chocolate Academy. And he has been working for our Calibo, the Belgian brand, in Belgium for 18 years before he moved to Canada. So he has a lot of chocolate experience. So if there's any questions you have on ganaches or on shelf life or anything about chocolate, why it doesn't melt or why it's this or that, he's a really good resource to ask, because I think he knows everything about chocolate.
Actually, Jérôme has a good class and academy for different level 1, 2, and 3. All right, so we take a ball, if we can find one. No? They went to get something. You can spray directly on a, so the, make sure before you spray your ganache, you make this at least a couple hours before, because if it's too hot, you put something warm on the top, it's going to slide a little bit or mix together. If you do this too early, like this one was made yesterday because for the production, that is not a very good way to do this, because you can feel it's completely dry. So what happens is, when I'm going to pour, even if it's warm, sometimes it's going to peel. This one doesn't peel. Also, what I like to do, like the one we did last week, I cut with a guitar, I let it crystallize, pretty much pour the ganache in the morning, the same night, cut, crystallize. You can put this inside, chef, if you don't mind. And what I like is to cut them, so the ganache around, and start to crystallize. So I always give a 24 hours crystallization completely. Because right now, the only crystallization you have it when you do something like this will be only on the top. Before you cut with a guitar, you put a little bit of chocolate tamper, but right now the only crystallization was on the top, so you don't crystallize properly the side. Okay? So, temper chocolate, tempering. If you don't, it's too many, it's not too many ways, but you can do on a marble, temper chocolate. I don't do this anymore. I believe it's old school for me. And it's also messy, you know, you put in, and it's a time consuming to clean everything. It's great to know this. I will say that for the new generation, because it's the way we learn. I don't say don't do it. I just say it was great to do this 25 years ago, 30 years ago, but it's good to do this when you're in school today, if you are. But I believe it's also different technique to do this. So example, if you do, you melt chocolate in a tamper, because you need to understand, the chocolate is right here on this box, is actually tamper, correct? It is, because it's, they take the from the factory and come to the tunnel, and at the end, when it comes, it's very tamper. So what you need to do is just melt, let's go say 5 kilo or 10 kilo of pistol. You know the temperature you need to melt if it's a dark, 45, 49. And after you add 20 to 30% of pistol. So when you add your pistol, you actually bring back and temper automatically your chocolate. That is one way when you know to do this and you feel very comfortable. Well, so it means you don't more than 10 times. The first time you're not going to see the crystallization, you're not going to make sure you don't feel comfortable. That is one way. The other way will be the marble, what is great to do with this also. And the other way also, people today start to temper chocolate is to add micrio inside also. So if you're not familiar with all those techniques, whatever worked the best for you, but for me, I believe just adding a little bit of pistol. When you add the pistol, you put your cover with your pistol, you turn down the temperature to 32 for the dark example. You make sure the machine using, you properly know the machine in a sense, sometimes you think it's 32, but there is not the temperature 32. So when you know all those detail, you know exactly what worked for you. You put a pistol, you agitate, you mix, you put the lid, you close for another 10, 15 minutes, you go back, you agitate one more time, you take the burr mixer without bringing too much air inside, and that's it, it's ready. After you do your test, your spatula, your paper, whatever you're comfortable to do this. Okay, question? Or you have a machine and you push the button, correct? It sounds like a lot of people have this.
Should all have one of those, right?
Do I?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You know.
Once you make your.
But I will tell you, it is a machine. Yeah, it is an investment. But if you start to produce, usually I will tell you by hand, you should be able to produce 1,200 to 1,500 pieces a day. That is a normal production at ours, technically. And I'm talking about molding chocolate. If you start to dip chocolate by hand, I would say a good average by hand would be maybe 600 to somebody who's very fast, 1,200 piece, depend, because it's time to enrobe. And it depends also the design, whatever you put on top. So yes, it's a big investment in a machine, but if you start to sell a lot of chocolate, I mean, think about it, you can enrobe pretty much not just doing the bonbon, but you can enrobe a marshmallow, you can enrobe a pretzel. I mean, so many things people do with this. So anyway, just want to show you, going to pour this right on top.
So I might have been a bad student, but you mentioned something about the texture of the gelée. Like, what, it was too dry now? Like, when were you supposed to put it on for the best result so it doesn't separate?
I will make the gelée like in the morning and pour in afternoon right away.
So it's a little sticky still. That's what you want.
No, in two, three, four hours, usually will be ready. Okay. If you do the next day, because the air conditioned thing like this, usually it's completely dry, completely you create a skin. So what happens when you pour this right now, and if the ganache is warm enough, it's okay, you're going to remelt a little bit the layer between. Otherwise, sometimes you're going to see the peel. So it's just to find the right balance between your air condition, your kitchen, or maybe because it's too hot in the kitchen, the chocolate also doesn't crystallize properly. So if it's the case, you need to put a little bit in a cooler to activate the crystallization. So all the detail and the factor is not about the chocolate itself, it's not about the cream. It's also all the things go behind, and sometimes we don't pay attention to this. We just say, wow, it doesn't work, it doesn't crystallize, or I don't understand, or it's bloom. It's not this. You need to understand and try to... The chocolate is a very... pastry is one thing, and chocolate is, I guess, is another way to see pastry. But the world of these, those questions, sometimes you don't understand why things doesn't work, is all about technology. So read a lot about chocolate, take a class as much as you can for you to become better and understand the behind of the chocolate. So you can see, pour the chocolate, frame, let it crystallize just like this outside. Usually I don't put the ganache in a cooler unless, let's go say somebody come to you and say, I want a 1,000 bonbons. You're going to say, I'm sorry, I cannot do because my chocolate is crystallized. You know, you have to do some what you have to do sometime in life. So if you have to push, accelerate the process, you put in a cooler. Right now what you're going to test, we're passing some bonbon. Here, what I'm going to do is, if you want, I'm going to, the chocolate, I believe, is almost ready.
So how is it? Tastes good? Strong cocoa chocolate flavor, but that's cocoa.
So if you have what is called acetate, will be much better than doing a parchment paper. So the idea when you do this, I don't know if you see very well on the TV, is to remove the excess, the most you have it.
No foot on those, they're all straight.
I don't do every day this, but it's good memory to do that today.
So when you come out there again, if you didn't have a chance to try all our chocolates, go out and try all the origin chocolates too. I think a lot of you have already tried them, but it's kind of interesting to see the different flavors from different countries. So they really taste different if they are from Tanzania or if they are from Venezuela or Ecuador. So go out and try those. And if anybody would ever be interested, our really highest end of chocolate would be our Or Noir, which is a really neat concept. You can go, you can work with our R&D lab in France and develop your own flavored chocolate. And you will work with them ahead of time for months, and then one day you'll go over there and they will have prepared all the different chocolate liquors, all the different flavors and what you have kind of indicated ahead of time that you like, and they will develop your own chocolate. And actually Chef Monty was there last year in the fall,
yeah,
and
we
developed their own pre-gel chocolate for the
yeah,
US.
We have our own brand chocolate right now in America, so it's great. We have a milk, we have 44% and we have a 72%. Fantastic, very, I'm very happy because we make this with the complicity to make, like I say, not just a mousse or a gelato or sorbet or thing like this, but also to try to create a chocolate where you have diversity to approach chef in a different category and bonbon or thing like this. So I'm very pleased. So if you come to the TC, you will test. We don't have here in Canada, but so I'm very happy. And Jerome helped me a lot also to develop this. This chocolate, we worked very hard for almost 6 months to create the right formula, what is, I believe fits exactly a customer. So that is what we did today. I hope you enjoy. So we open the floor now to conversation, to question if you have it. If you want to test more product outside, I'm sure they would be happy to go on the next room and to whatever sample, whatever you want to test. So thank you very much for coming. I know for you it's not too cold, but thank you for the drive, because I didn't see the sunshine. Today's warm day, true.
Yes. Yeah.
Look, you see what I wear? So thank you very much. I hope so you have a good time. And see you next time in Charlotte, if it's not around the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That was lovely. That was delicious and interesting.
So would you like to test one like this, fresh?
Thank you. I can't talk now because now I get to eat chocolate.
Okay, I'll take over for a second. We did have a question down here from before. So.
Yeah, I was just wondering what you could substitute for the gelatin base. Like if you want to use gelatin powder or sheets, can you use that where it calls for gelatin base?
Gelatin base, yes. So for substitute in a sense, you asked me for the ratio?
Yeah.
The ratio is a 2 gram, example, the 180 bloom, okay? So that is the gelatin, technically the leaf is 2 gram, and you will put 15 gram of gelatin base. So 15 for 2 gram, okay? Now, seda, okay, that is a 40 brush work for an average. But let's go say, it's not the case here, but let's go say you are in Miami, you do a party outside. Of course, we know we need more gelatin leaf and your mousse because the party is inside on, you know, and because it's 100 degrees outside. So at one point is, like you test today the mousse, is what the question is, what do you want to serve and how do you want to serve? And how do you want to educate your customer to understand, to say, by the way, when the cake is you bring from the pastry shop, you put in your cooler, can you please bring outside 5 minutes, 10 minutes before you eat? Or you already know those factors, and you pretty much told your customer, are you okay, just bring the cake right away? Because the texture changes a lot. Is you know, if you put more gelatin and you don't tell your customer, they take right from the fridge, it's like this. So. And if it's a verrine, you don't need so much because you don't need too much holding on a side because the dessert himself is not going to go nowhere.
Any other questions? Okay, go ahead.
Doing a double layer of pate de poulet, like two flavors. Mm-hmm. I've done it a couple times now, and last time I did it, it was separating. Like, I let it set for 4 hours at room temp and then poured on the next flavor. And they were still coming apart when I was putting them. It was separating both. So what's the best way?
Just because you were doing pate de poulet, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, the reason for this is because you let a pate de poulet set too long. It's exactly what I told you earlier. So if you let your pate de poulet set too long, when you pour the other one, at one point you already miss the connection. So it's not a matter of the pate de poulet is like 80 to 90 degree hot. It will never combine together. When you cut with the knife or the guitar, it will rest apart. So the best is make your first one, and usually I start with in a ratio of 20 to 30 minutes the next one pate de poulet. And I pour almost right away. So what you do, you take you cannot just pour with coming from the saucepan like this. What you do, you take a large spoon, flat, okay? And you pour on your spoon, and so like this, the spoon is like this, so you actually don't go deep this way. It's like almost like, what do you call this?
A fountain.
A fountain, exactly. Almost like Bellagio, thank you. So that is what happened. Your other pate de poulet will be, if it's too soft, it's going to go mixed right away. And if it's not, so you need to find the right amount of time. Usually 20 minutes is perfect. And using which pectin? Is the yellow?
No, it's not.
NH?
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyone else? Okay, so basically I'll just take a few minutes to give you a bit of more information on what Chef Monty was speaking about before, which was the five-star chef pastry series. In Canada at the moment, we don't have as great a training center as they do in the US. So we offer just introductory gelato classes, advanced gelato classes, and basically a frozen cakes, pops, and novelties class, and that's both in our Woodbridge, Ontario location and in our Surrey, BC location. If you want to get more specialized programs for specifically for pastry chefs with some of the best pastry chefs in North America, then I highly suggest the five-star chef pastry select series. Rodney and Chef Francesco actually did one late last year. Correct? Last fall?
Yeah, November.
Okay. Who was the chef?
With Jean-Michel Papillon.
Yeah, Jean-Michel also is an ambassador for Cacao Barry. Usually come once a year, do a class for us. A very nice, amazing chef, a good friend, and also it's great to see those people who want to share the knowledge and pass to people without, I want to say ego, but you know, sometimes a chef can be. So. You know, for us, I believe the school behind this, the purpose of this was to create something unique for the students, whatever they came from around. The value of this class is amazing. So I can tell you the price of the 3 days is $800, and that including also your 3 nights at the hotel, and your breakfast and your lunch. So what I mean is, for us, it's not about the class are not to make money. It's not the question about this. It's to continue to pass the knowledge and to educate people and to show what we do also. And that, I believe, is a great value for you. You know how difficult it is today when you work in a hotel or whatever you work and you say to your boss, hey, I want to invest on a class like this, and they look at you and say, sorry, we don't have the budget. Mm-hmm. So we put this in place now 5 years ago. And because the connection, like last year, Raymond Moato came. This year, he cannot come because he's too busy traveling for whatever his business. But I was able to get another chef from France. Like we have Frédéric Wacker, also is a MOF chocolatier, Jean-Michel Perruchon, and MOF glacier. No, I forgot his name. Let's come back. But anyway.
But if you want more information on any of those classes, you can go to the prejolcanada.com website, and there's a link directly to the five-star chef pastry select series, basically, and you can see the entire catalog or calendar for 2015.
The other chef is, remember now, his name is Emmanuel Rion, I don't know if you know, he's also an ambassador for Cacao Barry, France or Europe. He used to be the corporate pastry chef for Pushkin. I don't know if you know Pushkin, but he used to be a very nice one in New York. But they have like five, or at least three or four around the world right now.
Sorry, I didn't hear your question. Yes. So the Restaurants Canada show, which is formerly the CRFA show, is going to be taking place at the Direct Energy Centre Exhibition Place, March 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. It's the first, second, third, which is the Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. Prejal and Cacao Barry are going to be there. We're going to be at booth number 712. And you guys are at?
I can't remember. If you send me an email, it comes up as an automatic invitation. So,
yeah. The show in general is a great opportunity, at least for us, to connect with our existing customers, meet new customers. But it's great for whether you're an existing customer or you just want some more information on Prejal. It's a great way to see what we have that's new, and it's a great way to taste a lot of our products very, very quickly. So. We're going to have, I think, 8 flavors of gelato, some soft serve. We're going to have those pâte fouille that Chef was speaking about before. I think we have 3 different flavors, correct? Do you remember what they are? Key lime, apricot, and blood orange. So it's a great way to just sample a lot of the things that Chef was mentioning today, and some really great gelato, and have a nice few hours at the show. March 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, so in a few weeks. So
it's just in a few weeks.
Mm-hmm. But I will not be here. It's too cold.
Yeah, so we have, I don't know, you so probably have the same. We don't, unfortunately, don't have free tickets, but we have 50% if you enter the promo code. So if you send me an email, it actually, like, when I send an email back, it actually comes up on my, which is the promo code.
But I will be a food show, fancy food show in New York City. So if you're in New York City, stop by. It's not too far.
When is that again?
The food show? No, it's nice in New York.
So when is the fancy food show again?
Camille? So I believe it's 6 and 7, 8.
March?
Yes. So.
You still have time to do our show first.
So you, if you're going to have to work somewhere in between, you have to pick one or the other, I think.
Anyways,
it's
New York.
A week of vacation.
Anyway.
So we hope to see you there. Would be lovely. And if you have any questions, just please take our cards. You can call us anytime.
But just Luke again has the what do you call this?
Cotton candy.
The cotton candy?
Cotton candy, yes. How's he stay like this for a couple of hours and I've moved yet, so. I don't know if the cameraman people try this yet, but we should save a few pieces for them.
Thank you guys very much for your attention.
Yeah,
I hope
you
all
so
enjoyed.
Much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Chef.
Thank you, thank you. Women in Philly pen. It's silly when girls sell their souls because it's sin.